I came to Jesus weary, worn, and sad. He took my sins away. He took my sins away. Now his love has made my heart so glad. He took my sins away. Sabbath teaching, the order of events, number 4, December the 17th, 2016. It's always good to learn order of events in the Bible. That will help you understand some prophecies and also give you a mental concept of the New Testament. The more you learn, the more you're going to learn the writings of Paul. You know, as you grow in grace and knowledge, you begin to realize sometimes some of the things that these other churches are teaching and the way we was raised is in error. You know, I always was drilled and taught that the law was voided till I bumped into what Paul wrote. Preacher never said it. Preacher never read it. He said, "Do we nullify the law through faith?" And Paul said, "May it never be." About as strong as he could say it. And yet, sometimes it sounds like he's saying it is, sometimes he says it ain't. Got to understand, Peter said his words, his writings are hard to be understood. So when you've got the majority of what's called Christianity, that is the whore Revelation and her daughters, back in that other side, you know that's wrong. Just automatic, you know that's wrong. Yet you've got a lot of Acts 2:38 folks following the same trend Baptist, Methodist, and Catholics are following on that theology. You ought to know it's wrong if they're all believing that other side. Just automatic, someone quick. Few's going to find eternal life. We've got to settle down and realize this is the truth. Few is going to find it. And it helps to have an understanding of order of events of time and what took place in those days. Even though it may not be direct to us today, just understanding that will help us to have a grasp of it. Now, we're going through Nebuchadnezzar's dream, and the Babylonian Empire was the goal, along with the other side of Daniel's vision. Nebuchadnezzar's dream on the right, Daniel's vision on the left of the symbols, the lion with the two wings, the Medo-Persian Empire is the bear, along with the first, it was the gold and the silver. And it mentioned about the bear representing Persia. Then the Grecian Empire, the leopard. And it's a kingdom of brass, lesser than silver, lesser than gold. And it's like a leopard, but it had four wings in the vision on its back. And it also had four heads. Then you have the Roman Empire, different than all the others. And legs of iron, and then right down to the very toes, iron and clay, and in that vision. So these bring us all the way up to our day. Some say it stopped in Rome, but I don't believe that. I believe it comes up to our day. Again, we've looked at the Babylonian Empire, the first beast, the head of gold, the one with the lion, with the two wings, Nebuchadnezzar and Nebuchadnezzar, that actually set up that kingdom. And when it was plucked, Nebuchadnezzar was boasting like a king, a lot of kings do, until God humbled him down. And then he was given a heart, I think it said a flesh. And he changed his nature, went like a beast. So he calmed down a little bit. Following that was the Medo-Persian Empire, and it was the Medes. That when you read in the chapters, after Belshazzar saw the handwriting on the wall, it was the Medes that invaded that night. Now, why it says Medo-Persia? Medo-Persia are the two horns, and out of those two horns, you have the Medes first, they were first mentioned, then you have the Persian side. What brought them together was, I don't know the name, they're in history.
And you have the either the prince, one's a man, one's a woman, I don't know the names offhand, of the Median, and then the other one of the Persian, and they married. When they married, that joined the Persian kingdom and the Median kingdom. When they joined together, the Persian kingdom rose up higher. It tells us that in the scripture text. Well, that's the one that gave them authority for the Israelites to go back and rebuild Jerusalem. Just like God prophesied. Cyrus was the one that done it. God called him by name in Isaiah's day. Almost 200 years prior, close to that. So, you see how when you start seeing it, you realize God has control of all of this. So, he knows what he's doing in the world, even in politics. Okay, the third kingdom, the Grecian Empire, from 332 B.C. to 146 B.C., we'll look to some of this. It was the Greek city-states. I studied this in school in history and hated it. I hated studying about them, about Athens and Sparta and all that kind of stuff. Now it comes back and makes sense. You know, we'll get to more in that just a second here. We're going to look at Daniel 7 and 6 because we're talking about the Grecian Empire now. After this I beheld, and lo, another like a leopard, which had upon the back of it four wings of a fowl. The beast had also four heads, and dominion was given to it. So this is the Grecian Empire, the Greek Empire. Again, we have it. It's the third kingdom of brass on the Nebuchadnezzar's dream. And then it also has the leopard with four wings, the vision that Daniel had, and it had four heads. I don't guess it shows that little creature had four heads, but it did. And this is the one we're looking at. Here's the empire area. If you can see it clearly enough here, the Grecian Empire in 323 B.C. and its strength. Now what happened? The Grecian Empire, the Greek city-states were right on in here. The Persian Empire was all of this. If the Persians had not got greedy, they kept crossing the Aegean Sea and raiding these city-states that were not together in one government. They would raid them, plunder them, then go back to Persia, which infuriated the Greeks. So when Alexander the Great, his empire, he conquered from here all of this all the way to India. He done it in 10 years' time. That's something for their time back in those days when they only had horses and foot soldiers and things like that. They didn't have tanks, didn't have airplanes. They conquered the whole empire in 10 years of time. And that's the extent of the empire and its power, 323 B.C. Of course, Alexander died while he was in India, close to it anyway, close to that. Now we got the timeline area here. We'll look at Daniel's he-goat and ram vision. We've been going through these, leaving these. We've talked about Daniel's night vision here, the seven-time vision, the Nebuchadnezzar dream, the time Nineveh of a sack, Nebuchadnezzar, all this. We've looked at all this. Belshazzar's vision over there, Darius the Mede, defeats Babylon, and so forth, in one book. Well, in the third year of Belshazzar, before it gets to the point where he's put to death and killed, Daniel has a vision about the ram and the he-goat. When I first saw that, I thought it was the Mississippi River. You know how it is when you first get in church and you know A from B? I said, my goodness, they meet at that river. In the vision, that's what he said. I said, that means there's going to be one from the west and one from the east. Had nothing to do with us over there. But that's the first thing hit my mind in those days. I never forget that, how funny that was. The he-goat and the ram. The Persian Empire is the ram, and the Grecian Empire is the he-goat. Now, I didn't find one with one horn right here in his head, you know, like a unicorn thing. But the symbol in the night vision shows that, which represents Alexander the Great. And the Persian Empire infuriated the Greeks. And let's see what's next here. They infuriated the Greeks. Like I said, they only had city-states. Athens, Sparta, and if I can't name any more right offhand, but every one of them had like a fort castle, and each one had a king or ruler, and they just took care of their domain. When troubles come, people out of the fields would come behind the walls, they'd fight. If that city over there trying to take them. Kind of like Hickman against Union City or something like that. That's the way their whole system was set up like that. They didn't have one government like we've got here and so forth. The Persian Empire had a different thing. They had provinces. They had one centralized government. They kept, as I said, raiding the Greek city-states, plundering them. They've done this several times. They got tired of it. Now, Philip II of Macedonia tried to get them together. He was not successful. His son, Alexander the Great, he was about 20 years old, fired up. He went to all the city-states and got an army under his command from all the Grecians. So why they invaded Persia was because of them antagonizing them. When they went, when you're going to see, it says, he came at him in fury, in choler, and that represents the real heated anger. And why they done that, as I said, they kept raiding them. So they was fed up with it. And when they went to conquer them, it's just like a bulldozer. They went through that whole empire and took it over, went all the way to India. He had at least four generals. Now the scripture text, you're going to see as we read it. It says it has four wings on its back. Those are his four generals. When the kingdom is divided after Alexander dies of malaria, I think it was malaria, the empire is divided among the generals into four kingdoms, four heads. And then they're separate kingdoms under those generals up until the time when the Roman Empire rises. So the goat, the he-goat, and the ram. Daniel chapter 8. In the third year of the reign of King Belshazzar, a vision appeared unto me. Now Daniel's still in the Babylonian Empire. Belshazzar had not been slain. Medo-Persia had not conquered him yet. In this vision. So it's the third year of King Belshazzar of Babylon. A vision appeared to me, even unto me Daniel, after that which appeared to me at the first. And I saw in a vision. And it came to pass when I saw that I was at Shushan in the palace, which is in the province of Edom. And I saw in a vision, and I was by the river Euphrates. Then I lifted up mine eyes and saw, and behold, there stood before the river a ram which had two horns. And the two horns were high, but one was higher than the other, and the higher came up last. So, vision-wise, are you getting the picture? Now, this is before these developments. He's still in the third year of the reign of Belshazzar of Babylon. They're still in Babylon. The Israelites are, the Judean people, that is. This vision shows this ram has two horns. Now, I have to check history if I really want to dig into that and see when they married. When they joined together, and it says here, there were two horns were high, one was higher than the other, and the higher came up last, is the Persian side of this empire. And The Medo-Persian Empire, their Belshazzar's handwriting on the wall, invaded them that night and put Belshazzar to death. I think it was Darius the Mede that took over command. So when this happened, this is what this is talking about in prophecy. I saw the ram pushing westward and northward and southward. So get the picture of the Greek city-states. Get the picture of the present-day Turkey on the map part, if you know where it's at in your mind mentally. Then you will see where this ram was pushing west into the Greek city-states, pushing north into other areas, and south into the Holy Lands. He said, so that no beast might stand before him. Neither was there any that could deliver out of his hand, but he did according to his will and became great. So that's the Medo-Persian. And as I was considering, behold, a he-goat came from the west on the face of the whole earth. Touched not the ground. And the goat had a notable horn between his eyes. So that notable horn is Alexander the Great that's leading this army, and he's coming from the west, the Greek city-states, crosses the Aegean Sea, and meets the realm of Persia. Starts a war. And he said he don't touch the ground. He's swift like a leopard. You know, a leopard can run 70 miles an hour on sprint. And that's why this beast system of the Grecian Empire, he came from the west and he touched not the ground. He was swift. In 10 years, conquered a huge empire. And he came to the ram that had two horns, which I had seen standing before the river, and ran unto him in the fury of his power. Again, showing the anger of the Greek city-states. Alexander is 20 years old. So he's just barely above a teenager. He's leading an army. He is a general. But he is fired up for his people. He runs into them with the fury of his power because they're angry at them. I mean, you would if some country kept invading yours over and over and over. You get a belly full. And that's what his Grecian Empire is doing to Persia. Put them on the run. And I saw him come close into the ram, and he was moved with choler against him. High anger. And smote the ram, brake his two horns. And there was no power in the ram. By the way, the leader of the Persian, the king, he fled on a chariot for his life, trying to get away after the Grecian army had done decimated his. They caught him. Now, if I understand history correctly, I think they put him to death. Smote the ram, brake his two horns, and there was no power in the ram to stand before him. But he cast him down to the ground and stamped upon him. There was none, nobody could deliver the ram out of his hand. So Alexander had a free reign. His army decimated the empire of the Persian Empire. Therefore the he-goat waxed very great. When he was strong, the great horn was broken. What do you mean strong? The extent of that empire we showed you went all the way to India. That means all of Iran today, all of Afghanistan, all of Iraq, the whole Middle East, all the way to India. That he controlled that now. His armies control that. In the strength of their power. Then he dies. God is showing this while he's still in Babylon. God knew that Alexander was going to die right there. Now see, just learning this lets us know how God's got control of everything. He sees today what's happening 100 years out yonder that we might not even know nothing about. He sees it. Just like I said, he's got a place prepared in the wilderness. He sees that place. He sees, hopefully, us there. Somebody said, I don't want to be out there in the woods. I don't want to be there better than where I'll be if I don't get there. The Lord God has got under control. As that angel told me, he said, he showed me in the wilderness as my Bible laying on a stream of water, and I went and picked it up. I got the message without, didn't say a word. Preserved in the wilderness by the word of God. It's all I needed. I knew it. Showed him about that nuclear war. Come, I'll show you something. You're living in the damn nuclear war. Warning. You know they're planning on nuking this planet as they go underground? I don't know if they're trying to be merciful to the people on top of it and just kill everybody off. They're going to protect their super elite people and try to exterminate everything on the planet because they don't want us. They've got a plan that they're going to survive this thing, come out on the other side, and have a new world order. That's what their plans are. God sees it all. The great horn was broken. Alexander dies. For it came up four notable ones toward the four winds of heaven. Here's the map. Look at it real quick. You understand the layout pretty well if you know this area. Here's Egypt. There's Macedonia, Sparta, Athens, Pella. And if you go to the New Testament, you'll find where Corinth and Thessalonica and all them is in Macedonia. You know. Then you have this area here was divided up. So you've got four kingdoms. Now we got it listed there. The four wings on the back of this beast in the vision. Well, he's seeing this in the third year of Belshazzar. Medo-Persia ain't even went down. Ain't even come to power. Yet he's showing him Greece. He's showing him the Greek city-states. He's showing him Alexander dies. He's showing him four kingdoms arise out of this. God knew it. Ptolemy won the first soldier. He rules the Egyptian kingdom as they divide this territory up right here. His general, one of his generals. You know, they had a big funeral. History says they all, the generals wept because they loved Alexander for what he done for Greece, their country. I mean, they would, you know. And they highly respected Alexander. But when he died, then they had to divide the domain among the four generals. God told Daniel, while he was in Babylon in captivity, even before Medo-Persia had passed, what the Greek city-states, what Greece would do. So Ptolemy, the Egyptian kingdom, Lysimachus, or how you pronounce that name right there, he gets the Thracian kingdom right here in this cup. Cassander gets the Macedonian kingdom right here in the green. And Seleucus the first, Nicator, gets called the Seleucid kingdom, all the way from here, and it gets to the layer right here, it gets around Jerusalem, and all the way over to India, which didn't last long. They kept chopping it away. Other, maybe India and other countries did, and it chopped it down some, but he still retained it for a pretty good while. So that's the layout of that, and that is those four kingdoms, the four heads that he saw on the leopard. That's a significance. That's what it meant. Okay, again, verse 8. Therefore, the he-goat waxed very great. When he was strong, the great horn was broken, for it came up four notable ones toward the four winds of heaven. Now, here's where it jumps time. Some say it had to do with Antiochus, or what his name was. He did desecrate the temple. He did do that. He took a pig in the temple in Jerusalem during the days of Maccabees. We don't have those books. Catholic Bible has it. Maccabees 1, Maccabees 2. And Antiochus, I can't pronounce his name correctly, did desecrate that temple, did put a pig in there, and because they know how the Israelis hated that, so he done it. But when you look at the writings, now some say that's abomination of desolation. I think Church of Christ teaches that, if I'm not mistaken. Some of the others. However, in Jesus' day, he said, when you see the abomination of desolation. So that means what he's talking about hadn't come yet. And when you read Matthew chapter 24, about let them flee to the wilderness. Now some of them say, well, that was back there when 70 AD they burnt the temple down. Burnt Jerusalem down. I said, but you read the verses after that. It's talking about the days of the great tribulation, which is in our day, and then it mentions about the sun turned dark, moon in the blood, and showing the sign of the coming of the Son of Man, so forth and so on. So that's for our day. And there's other scriptures you can prove that one verse jumps sometimes 1,000, 2,000 years in time, lay out a prophecy. I think it's in Revelation 12, talked about the man-child was called up to God and his throne, Jesus of Nazareth. The next thing, it talks about the woman fled to the wilderness. It talks about, if you look at all the scripture texts related to that, that woman is facing the Antichrist of the last days. So two verses, verse 5, verse 6, skip almost 2,000 years of time. Here, it talked about those four kingdoms, and it says, out of one of them came forth a little horn, which waxed exceeding great toward the south, toward the east, and toward the pleasant land. And it waxed great even to the host of heaven, and it cast down some of the host and of the stars to the ground and stamped upon them. You know, the Antichrist is going to make war with the saints. Yea, he magnified himself even to the prince of the host. And by him the daily sacrifice was taken away, and the place of the sanctuary was cast down. A host was given him against the daily sacrifice by reason of transgression, abomination of desolation. And it cast down the truth to the ground, and it practiced, and it prospered. Then I heard one saint speaking, and another saint said unto that certain saint which spake, how long shall be the vision concerning the daily sacrifice and the transgression of desolation, which we call abomination of desolation, or something like that. How long will be the vision concerning the daily sacrifice and the transgression? Put them together. How long will it be to give both the sanctuary and the host to be trodden under foot? How long? The angel, the saint asked the other saint. He said unto me, unto 2,300 days, and then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. And it came to pass, when I, even I, Daniel, had seen the vision, and sought for the meaning, then behold, there stood before me as the appearance of a man, and I heard a man's voice between the banks of Gilea, which called and said, Gabriel, make this man to understand the vision. Okay, here's a layout, time chart of the 7 years of the last days of time from the, confirm that we ain't went to that part of the scripture yet, we will probably later. 69 of the 70 weeks are already expired, we've only got 1 week remaining. Some have tried to say when Jesus died, that was half of that week, it can't be. Bible says he died after the 62nd week, plus you put the other 7 to it, you got 69. After the 69 week, Christ dies. There's still 1 week remaining. We went into the times of the Gentiles. Paul said, blindness in part has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in. Then the Lord God's fixing to return back and deal with Israel itself. They're 7 years. Now, here's what your 2,300 days are, the yellow part. How long shall be the abomination of desolation along with the animal sacrifices? Remember, that's one thing that I did find in favor with Irvin Baxter about going over and talking to Gershon Solomon. He was the leader of the Temple Mount Faithful. They're wanting to build the temple in Jerusalem. They got everything together ready to start it. They need a red heifer to sacrifice to sanctify the priesthood. They're going to go back to animal sacrifices. Somebody said, they'll never do that. First of all, they don't know Jesus Christ. That's why they'll do that. And God said they're going to do that. And I calculated that they can have that temple built according to the 2,300 days and time to get into the 7 year part, less than a year. And I read in his magazine where he talked to Gershon Solomon. He said, we've got everything together, and once we start, we can get it done in less than 1 year, was his words. When they get that temple up, they start offering animal sacrifices. It will last approximately, I'm guessing, maybe some numbers I looked at, 1,080 days, thereabout. Then the Antichrist breaks the covenant. When he places the abomination of desolation, and Jesus said, when you see that, flee. The abomination of desolation, plus the sacrifice part, all of it together, 2,300 days over there. And it'll come out to 1,260 days that this Satan's going to make war with the saints. And remember he said the temple would be cleansed. Okay, you've got the 1,260, 42 times and a half, and all that kind of stuff. But all of a sudden you see a number 1,290 days. It's 30 days more than the two prophets prophesied, more than we're in the wilderness time, and so forth. The abomination of desolation in the 11th chapter of Daniel, he's fighting a war, the Antichrist is. He hears the trouble out of the north and out of the east, which no doubt is probably Russia and China and their armies. He goes to make war with them. And then that's when your three spirit, unclean spirits like frogs get them together and unite, and then they invade Israel. But during the time while this is going on, the Israeli people, and some people say, well, the Antichrist has got to be a Jew. I don't know where they get that at. You know, they think he's got to be a Jew. The Jews hate him. And they also, a lot of them are coming on now, see them on Facebook, thinking that the horror revelation, the Catholic Church is the beast. I said, she's not the beast. She rode the beast. In the last days, the 10 horns of that beast will hate the whore. Will pluck her flesh and burn her with fire, along with the Protestants and anything else claiming Jesus. So, those 30 days are for cleansing the temple. The Antichrist, according to Paul, sets himself up as God as he sits down in the temple. Probably where the high mercy seat is, all that kind of stuff. He goes in there and sets himself down like he's God. That's an abomination. That's what it's talking about, the abomination of desolation. When he marches into Jerusalem that day doing that thing, Jesus Christ said, when you see about it or hear about it, he said, it's time to flee. He's fixing to make war with the saints. He's going to have the upper hand for 1,260 days there, 3.5 years. He's going to behead people, put them to death, do this, do that, if you're not in a blessed area. They will pull out anything that had to do with him out of that temple and trash it while he's off and making a war. They're going to revolt the Israelis' will. They're cleansing it for 1 month. They're getting ready for the 1,335 days mentioned in Daniel of the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. They're getting ready for that. So that's what some of Daniel's prophecy is talking about on this other. So he came near where I stood. And when he came, when Gabriel, I was afraid and fell upon my face. He said to me, "Understand, son of man, for at the time of the end shall be the vision." Now as he was speaking with me, I was in a deep sleep on my face toward the ground. But he touched me. I guess that's what he got that song at. Somebody touched me. And set me upright. Watch out. What would you do if you saw a real angel? I don't care if it's Gabriel, the best one in there. I could think, well, Daniel talked to him, Mary talked to him, 500 years apart. And if he was to appear to me and say, "I'm Gabriel," I think I'd hit the dirt. Now, some God sent an angel to you that's been around for a long time, has seen all this, been involved with it, came down and talked to Daniel. Time came, he said, "Go tell that little girl named Mary, she's going to have a baby." Same angel. He's still alive today. Who knows what he'll be doing. Now as he was speaking with me, I was in a deep sleep on my face toward the ground. He touched me and set me upright. And he said, "Behold, I will make thee know what shall be in the last end of the indignation. For at the time appointed, the end shall be. The realm which you saw having the two horns are the kings of Media and Persia." So it tells us there what they are. You don't want to guess around, think we're guessing. It tells us. The two horns are Media and Persia. The rough goat is the king of Grecia. And the great horn that's between his eyes, that's the first king. That's Alexander the Great. Their general, their leader. Now, that being broken, again, Daniel is in the third year of Belshazzar in Babylon. Medo-Persia has not come to power, neither has Greece. That being broken, whereas four stood up for it, four kingdoms shall stand up out of the nation, but not in his power. That is not under Alexander's power, because he died. All that known, even before they got there. And in the latter time of their kingdom, when the transgressors are come to the full, a king of fierce countenance, understanding dark sentences, shall stand up. That will be the little horn that has eyes like the eyes of a man that can see everything, probably modern technology. Do you know they're saying that they don't even have you on a phone to know what you're saying if they really want to? I didn't know that. That's according to this guy, John Moore. I think it was him, maybe another one, general, that was in the military and intelligence. He said, anywhere you are at and they want to eavesdrop in on you by the technology they have, they could drop in and hear our conversation without us having a cell phone on or anything. Satellite technology, I guess. So they spy on anybody, anywhere, once they find out where they're at. You wonder why they're always outdoing the leaders of the Muslims, that they send a drone after them and find them in a car and blow it to pieces and they kill that guy. How'd they find it out? Those people won't even use the same cell phone when they use it. They throw them away. They know they're using them, but they still find them. He said they've got that technology. And his power, talking about the little horn, shall be mighty, but not by his own power. He shall destroy wonderfully, shall prosper in practice, and shall destroy the mighty and the holy people. He's going to destroy God's people best he can. If you ain't in a blessed area, if people in Judea do not flee to the wilderness, they'll be put to death if they stay in Jerusalem. If we're not in a place where God said be, we could be put to death. Through his policy Also he shall cause craft to prosper in his hand. He shall magnify himself in his heart, and by peace shall destroy many. He shall also stand up against the prince of princes. So I'm presuming that Jesus of Nazareth. What is that in Revelation 19? Jesus is coming back symbolically, sit on a horse. Now, I don't know if he lived to be on one, maybe, maybe not. The Antichrist forces are going to make war. They probably think it's an alien invasion from space. So they make war. Jesus has no problem with dealing with them. He's coming in flaming fire. He destroys them to blood flow at the hide of a horse's bridle. That's what's going to happen. But he shall be broken without hand. No problem. Jesus just flip him out of the way. And the vision of the evening and the morning, which was told, is true. Wherefore shut thou up the vision, for it shall be for many days. And I, Daniel, fainted, and was sick certain days. Afterwards, I rose up and did the king's business, and I was astonished at the vision, but none understood it. So he went on talking about it. He said, nobody understood it. He said, I didn't even understand it. The Greek timeline, real quick. In 498, Persia invades Greece, was the year. Started raiding. Between 498 and 448 was the Greco-Persian Wars. I used to know the name of two of them. One of them was in 490, another one was in 480. And I can't remember what all happened, but I remember reading and studying the history part of it. Greek and Persian Wars. 336, there was the death of Philip of Macedon. He tried to get them together to unite. They wouldn't listen too much to him. But in 334, Alexander the Great began his conquest. When he took power and his daddy died, he got them together. I don't know what he done, but he's either a good talker or done a little arm twisting in politics, maybe. He got them together. In 334 was the Battle of Granicus, 333 the Battle of Issus, 331 the Battle of Arbela, and 323 Alexander died. They say he died in 323, 333, about 11 years. They conquered Persia and he dies. 146, Greece is made a Roman province in 146, and I think in 27, Egypt.
He took my sins away, took my sins away. Keeps me singing every day. I'm so glad he took my sins away, took my sins away.